on. Three sides of the coin this week. Special guest. Ignore Tommy. We always do, but this week really ignore him. Tod Howarth joins us.
Tommy wants me to roll in bacon.
No, I just asked you if that was your like yearly ritual.
And you're going to go for the wet spot? Is that joke?
This is Three Sides of the Coin, talking all things KISS.
I want to rock and roll all night.
You're listening to Three Sides of the Coin.
So you love the show. Go to itunes.threesidesofthecoin.com and leave your review and rating of Three Sides of the Coin. Thanks.
Everybody, welcome back to another episode of Three Sides of the Coin. I am one of your three co-hosts, Michael Branville. As always, I'm joined by Tommy Summers. And somewhere you can hear in the distance a flush.
Someone bleeding the weasel.
That would be our third co-host, Mark Cicchini. We are in such a rush to finish up that we decided to start without Mark. He had more important business to do. So, let's get the, by the way, Mark, we are recording right now. Say hi to everybody.
Oh, fuck.
we're recording because we want to get this done and over with.
Oh, good. Let's go. Cause I got shit to do too. So,
so there's our third.
Hey, that's it. God won't fucking go. See you later.
There's our third co-host, Mark Cicchini. He's freshly drained.
Yep.
All right, guys, we're going to keep this short. We've got a special guest with us today. Tommy, I'll give you a shot. One comment you want to read?
Well, you know, not really, because there's so many great ones being rushed right now. So I'm just going to leave it at this. We got a lot of really great feedback from this week's show, which is the show about Cheap Trick. A few people didn't like it, but that's okay if you're not a Cheap Trick fan. But the coolest part was these people, our fans, who made lyrics and wrote a song for the Stallion.
I mean, the Vinnie Vincent song. I kid you not. We've had entire songs, multiple verses and chorus. I mean, it's, you guys rock that you wrote a whole song like this.
It's absolutely fantastic. So for all of you that are watching this show now, go back a week on YouTube specifically, I believe more so than Facebook, and just read some of these posts, because it's just, it's too funny. It really is.
Yeah. You know,
you guys are so incredibly creative.
Just incredibly good comments on the Cheap Trick show. You know, we even had good comments. We didn't really get a chance to talk about it, but the previous week's show, which was us talking about KISS and all their complaining and all that other stuff, lots of good comments and feedback to that show as well. I think we did like over 7,000 plays in the first week on that show alone.
A lot of great conversation. Yeah. Speaking of the Three Sides of the Coin family, thank you. Oh my God, my birthday was over the weekend. On this page alone, I think it was over 200 likes. I had over 200 people thank me on my personal page. A lot of them are fans of the show. God, you guys rock. Thank you. You have no idea. Because I'm really a sucker for that kind of stuff. I'm kind of the big teddy bear type about that. That shit gets me. Thanks, man. That's awesome.
I mean, it does. You know, we may come across as the asshole, but you know what? It does mean a lot to us.
Okay, so yeah, I'm just going to give you just a smidgen of this. Okay, so this is Mr. Blackwell, who always comments. He's great. Every week he's got something to say. Ride the wild pony, cried the Stallion in heat. Set your barbecue on fire and I'll give you the meat.
Hey, I'm stealing that. That's good.
That's right up there with burn, bitch, burn, bitch, burn. Let me put my log in the fireplace.
Exactly. It's just sinking. Yeah.
Okay, so here's going to be our next homework. Is after we get a bunch of these songs submitted, we need to get some musicians to actually record a couple of these so we can hear them. And I love the one song where he goes, the break here is now an 8-minute guitar solo.
That was funny too. Like
should run some of this by some of my musician friends. They might get a kick out of it.
Oh, it's gonna be great.
We think about that. Just almost like Spinal Tap. You know, run them big bottom, that kind
of
stuff.
You know, hey Alex, you're listening to this week's show. Let's get you some of these Vinnie Vincent lyrics. And get Shameless to record one of these tracks.
That'd be awesome. You could do all just bass, you know?
We got to find a Vinnie Vincent impersonator who can do the 8-minute guitar solo, though.
He could also write a verse about being on the bus with him and there's wig shifting or something.
Too funny. You guys really are the best fans. You guys, yeah, we love it. We love it. We love it.
Hold on, Michael, because I got one more thing. A contributor to Three Toys, always. Crash Crafton? Crash?
Okay, yeah.
He's been in the hospital for the last week. A great, great guy. I always see him pop up. He sends me stuff throughout the year, especially digging into me because I'm a Lions fan. He's been laid up in the hospital, and I tell you what, a lot of times you see people have been laid up in the hospital. And don't get me wrong, they're in the hospital. They put some pretty, you know, somber posts. Fucking his has been hilarious. He's just totally made light about the whole fucking thing. They've been very entertaining and funny, and I tell you what, I love people who look at life that way. And so Crash, when you see this, I think I saw on one of your posts that you're getting out tomorrow. Yeah, get better.
Good.
Hopefully you feel better. We're thinking of you here on the show, and go Lions.
I want to do a real quick
fourth in the division.
A real quick housekeeping, because it's starting to get close now. Tuesday, July 12th, come out to the Minnesota meetup that Tommy and I will be at the heavy metal
M-E-E-T.
The what?
M-E-E-T.
We're going to be at the Heavy Metal Grill, Marty's place.
Serving communion.
Serving meatloaf communion. Scott Lawrence is going to be playing some rare KISS tracks for us live. 3 o'clock in the afternoon, we're going to try and record a show. Mark will be recording remotely on Skype, and we'll be at the restaurant, and we'll have some swag to give away.
Well, yeah, and for all of you that are complaining about the time slot, come after work.
Come after work. We'll be there as long as we can hang out there. We just 3 o'clock is when we would normally record the show, so we'll record the show and then hang around and stay around and, you know, enjoy the meatloaf with everybody. So we got a special guest this week. This week we are joined by one of the members of Four by Fate. Tod Howarth sits down with us this week. And Tod's in the house. Really cool discussion. Let's just go right into it. Tod Howarth, formerly of Frehley's Comet, now with Four by Fate.
Take three sides of the coin with you anywhere. Download your 5-star rated free smartphone app today and listen on your Android or Apple smartphone. Visit android.threesidesofthecoin.com or ios.threesidesofthecoin.com.
So I want to welcome a special guest. This is the first time Tod Howarth has been on Three Sides of the Coin. Tommy, you had him on Dropping the Needle once when I wasn't available to do the show, but you and Mitch did a Dropping the Needle with Tod, right?
Yes, we did. And yeah. Tod was kind enough to play and everything. It
was
awesome.
That's right. So this is your first time appearance on Three Sides of the Coin. We want to welcome Tod Howarth. And just so everybody knows, this is Four by Fate. That's Todd's new band with John Regan. And we're going to be doing a lot of talk about that and just general talk about KISS and Ace and everything else. So, Tod, welcome.
Well, thank you so much, guys. Michael, Tommy, Mark, I appreciate it. That's fantastic. I'm glad to be here. My debut venture of Three Sides of the Coin.
So let's guys, where do we start? Do we start at the end and work backwards, or do we start at the beginning and work up towards Four by Fate? What's the best?
No, let's start at the end and work our way backwards. So
okay,
let's start with the whole thing, because it started with Mitch's charity CD, correct? Is that where this whole thing started, Tod? That's my recollection.
Yeah. Yeah, John had, I guess Mitch had contacted John and asked him to do some tracks or to see if he contributed anything like, you know, bass tracks or songs or whatever he could for the cause. And John agreed. And I think in that process, John had said, hey, we see if we'll do this too, because, you know, I can get a hold of him real quickly. And John did, and so did Mitch, for that matter. I said, sure, I'd love to do something. And then I think it was John's idea to re-record Breakout, which we did do via the pretty much the internet recording, and it came out pretty damn good.
Todd, was there any prior to Mitch calling John and then getting you involved? Did you and John ever have any discussions about, hey, let's form our own band, or let's try and get Frehley's Comet back together? Was that ever anything that you guys, you know, behind the scenes were working on?
Oh, yeah. We talked about it for 10 years now. John and I kept in contact. Sometimes we wouldn't talk for quite some time, actually. But usually, I think, maybe at least once a year in the beginning. And the main nucleus there was that John, I thought, it'd be great to get to play together in a project. He went back with Peter, and that took up a lot of his time and his energy. And in the meantime, we'd always thought...
Peter Frampton, right?
Peter Frampton, right. And we thought about, you know, we should do a couple handful of shows with Ace in New York or across the United States or even Europe, just for fun and for the fans, and see what would happen. But, you know, Ace was in and out with KISS again, and then he has his solo deals, and floating around a lot. I think mostly at about the time just before or just after we did this, the benefit hospice, the Canadian hospice, this project that we did with Breakout and a few other tunes. And we finally got a hold of Ace and some of his handlers and friends, and Ace had passed on it primarily. He was busy doing his own deal, and so that's really what helped to start Four by Fate.
So Ace's passing on it didn't damper it for you. You guys were just like, well, that's fine. We'll just continue moving forward then without you.
Oh, yeah, pretty much. I mean, you know, John has a lot of things he's done and opportunities to do. But we wanted to do something that we enjoy the band together. I've had my solo projects, and I've actually been approached by a lot of big bands that I have not mentioned that, you know, wanted me to go out with them. And a lot of them were very attractive offers, ideas, but I always wanted to do my own thing. And so this thing with John and me turned out to be what we really wanted to try to do. Even though Ace said, you know, he'll pass on the Comet thing, we thought, well, okay, that's fine. Maybe it will come up eventually later on. We don't know. I mean, we'll do it for the fans, and that's contingent upon Ace saying, yeah, well, let's do this. But until then, you know, John and I are going to do what we want to do, and hopefully together.
I think that's great. So was it, you guys had always maintained a friendship, hadn't you, through all these years? So you talk on and off again?
Was it Ace? Did you say Ace? John?
You and John? You and John?
Oh, yeah. John and I were always friends. There was actually never any hard feelings with anybody in the project. Or ever, really. I think there was probably a little bit of... when it was said by whomever that Ace had fired me, that was the only time I was like, wait a minute, what? Nobody fired me. I quit the band. I mean, you know, that wasn't the case at all. So anytime they came up where it sounded like somebody was making some stuff up, that was a little annoying. But yeah, we've all, I mean, in the limited times that I have spoken and seen Ace over the years, there's been absolutely no problem. I mean, he's come down here a couple of times and I'd go down to see him, and I'd end up talking more to Gene and Paul than Ace.
Todd, you're down in Southern California, San Diego area, and my understanding is that's where Ace lives. Have you run into him down there at all?
No, it's funny. When I was talking to Eddie Trunk here just a while back, he had mentioned the same thing. Maybe you'll run into him getting a loaf of bread at the store or something. But no, I have not. I mean, it was a few years back, I went to a book signing of his up in Oceanside, and I gave him my new contact information, and I knew that he was living in San Diego. Just coincidentally, I'm surprised he never tried to reach out to me. But even after that, he never contacted me. He said he would try to get together after the holidays. It was around Christmas time. But that never came to pass, and I still have yet to hear from him.
Hmm. Now, with 4 by Fate, when you realized Ace wasn't going to be part of it, did you and John, how do I phrase this? Did you decide to sort of make this, well, let's just do Frehley's Comet without Ace Frehley? Or did this then become just a completely different band? Does that make sense?
Yeah, it does. That's a very good question. Actually, the onset for the project, the idea was to do some Frehley's Comet and some KISS songs, just to appeal to the broader demographics of fans that we did have or do have. As time progressed, it morphed into more of, well, let's not make it so much about a KISS and Comet, because then it's going to just seem like a coattail band. And although it's maybe flattering and fun for some fans, the long-term idea of it did not appeal to either me or John. So we decided to make it more of a band and play some Frehley's Comet tunes and kick in maybe a couple of Ace Comet tunes that were associated with KISS, if that makes sense.
Okay. Yep. So how did the sound, the style of 4 by Fate then evolve? Because, you know, as a longtime KISS fan and big Frehley's Comet fan, you know, I've got that first Frehley's Comet album is just, it's right up there with me in Ace's solo projects. It's like right after the 78 solo album, it's the Frehley's Comet debut. So how did you evolve the sound to go, well, you know what, we're not going to try and follow on the coattails to that, and you're going to be yourself, I guess?
Well, when you get the blend of Ace playing in any given song, or his selections of the songs that he wants to have on an album, and then his iconic guitar playing, and even some of his very stylistic singing, that really gives or lends itself to be more of a Frehley's Comet type feel. For 4 by Fate, John and I have always been pretty heavy, even though as soon as I start singing, nothing sounds really that heavy. But my guitar work and John's bass playing, very, very heavy bottom end feel for us, or for our age group, I guess, of that era. And it kind of comes naturally with my songwriting, the delivery and the production, the idea, the direction, musical direction, and the sound and the character of the band just kind of shaped up naturally for us, because I take a lot of my new influences that I've had over the last, you know, 20 plus years, and my natural style, which really hasn't deviated too much, but that is principally the 4 by Fate sound. Then we added guitar player, songwriter, and sometimes lead singer Pat Gasparini in the mix. And he writes a lot of songs very similar to the way I write. So we're just really excited for the songs that he put on this record. And then the co-writing and stuff we'll do for the next record is going to be even more of a straight-on, heavier meld.
You know, and it's interesting that you said the sound for you and John is heavier. Because when I listened to the 4 by Fate album, you know, and I had no idea what it was going to sound like.
Right.
All of a sudden, I was like, wow, this is just much heavier than the Frehley's Comet album. So,
yeah.
And you know, and I'm not saying that in a bad way at all. It's just, it's a heavier album. And I guess if you were, and it's unrealistic to think this, if you thought you as in fans, were going to get a Frehley's Comet part 2 that follows right after that debut album, this is not that style of an album. I mean, that came out when? In 1987? 87.
Well, Yeah, and this stuff sounded a lot more current to me, if for the lack of a better term. But I agree, Michael. It was much heavier. But I also when I was listening through the disc, several of those songs, Todd, to me at least, sound different from one another. It's not just, you know, like if you put on, I don't know, Two's Blackstone Cherry, for instance. Okay, they're very consistent with every song, whereas this one was unique in the respect that one song, even though it was all heavier, sounded kind of like this, but then the other one sounds a little bit like that. So it was a nice deviation, I think, from just exactly the same thing. But I had no preconceived notion going in either, because I wasn't sure what to expect.
Very true. And there's contributing variables for that. A lot of fans don't like it when it's not consistent. And then there's many more fans, I think, like it when it's diverse a little bit here and there, as do I. The reason that some of the songs sound differently is there's two different reasons. There's two different drummers. But that's not okay. So, I mean, that may be approached because the first six songs we recorded with the late A.J. Perro had a definite feel, and all the songs, with the exception of one, were written by me with a heavier kind of dark side to them. And then the second six, we did two covers, and we had our current drummer and new drummer, Rob Afuso from Skid Row, play the drums there, so it has kind of a different feel. But the urgency of getting this stuff done, I think, contributed to maybe the differentiation in the styles. I don't mind that so much. And yes, you're right about the fact that it's a heavier type feel. In fact, our first guitar player, the great Sean Kelly, who has three leads on this CD, he thought, and he's a great guy, we're still good friends, but you know, it flat out, he thought it was going to be a continuation of like the Frehley's Comet stuff. So when we did the first six songs and he made his contributions, He called me up and said, "Hey, you know, love you, love the band, but I'm gonna have to bow out because this is a lot heavier than I thought it was gonna be." And I respected his position, his opinion, and so he did in fact bow out because it's just a heavier type feel.
Real quick question, Tommy. So how does that affect a brand new band that's trying to get their footing and get a recording? You guys went through some pretty drastic lineup changes.
The amount of hurdles we've had to jump with this band is unbelievable. There'll be more description, more writings about it, I guess, in depth or in print, whatever, later on. But I mean, to this day, I am jumping through hurdles and hoops to make this happen. I mean, I'm right in the middle of building my second studio right now, and doing a bunch of other stuff while I'm doing this music project. So I'm like a dead man walking. But that's why we came up with the title for this CD being Relentless, because I have an amazing amount of energy for an old guy. And John, you know, being the old world Italian, you know, he's pretty dead set on getting what he wants to get accomplished as well. And then with Pat Gasparini, the new guitar player, he's persistent and full of energy too. And Rob is diversified in a couple of different things that he's doing. It's just, we're looking at it now, and we're coming up on about 3 years of getting this project together. And I hate things that are incomplete or not completed in the sense of you start it and you don't finish it. I mean, I've always been that way. It's kind of there's some background on that too, but I got to finish something once I start it. It's like a book. I read extensively. So if I start a book, you bet your butt it's going to be finished, because I can't leave it unfinished.
Was it a challenge keeping the sound that you and John wanted through all of these lineup changes?
Yes, with respect to the fact that we did one half of the album at like almost a half a year, or not, was it 5 months maybe in between the next half? So you've got the different sounds, different temperatures, different drummer, different mic setting, acoustic settings, changes in the studios. There are little idiosyncrasies that change it up a little bit, which adds to that different sound for each track, but also can be somewhat annoying for the consistency of the album or the CD. And these are things that are, you can't help given the situation and the conditions under which we were recording. I mean, we had our first drummer almost ready to come in. He gets in a car wreck, a Stett Howland from Wasp. We had to replace him days with AJ Perro from Twisted Sister, taught him the songs right there in the studio, and then, you know, unfortunately he passes away later on from a heart attack. And then we had to do the same thing with Rob, getting him in there. The hurdles again and sound differentiation. I mean, I think other people, lesser people, probably would have given up, or they would have produced something that sounded like crap, because it's just, it's so hard to at least make them sound a little consistent. But we tried, but we didn't overtry to make it sound like, well, they overtried.
Well, and all, for all fairness, I want to clarify my statement for the folks who haven't heard the CD yet. When I say it's diverse, it's not like one song sounds like Deep Purple and the next one sounds like Frank Sinatra. It's just different songs in a similar genre. And it seems to me like the heaviness of the music would fit right in there with some of the artists of today, at least from my perspective after seeing a bunch of them over the last month or so at a big festival. You know, is your goal with this band to do something like that, where you're on a tour with some of these bands or doing festivals, or what's the goal?
Well, first off, thanks, Tommy, for that reiteration of what you meant. I think I knew what you meant. The goal for the band is to get out there and start doing some shows. In this day and age, you know, we are a new band, regardless of the pedigree, the resume. You know, no, we're not a super band. We're just a band of, you know, pretty good musicians with great resumes. So we have to virtually start all over again. We understand that. So we'll be doing some fly-in, fly-outs, maybe some weekend shows. And if we're lucky enough, we can try to catch a couple weeks here and there. Through the end of the year, I'm not so sure how that'll work out. But, you know, that remains to be seen.
Todd, did you go ahead, Tommy?
Well, I want a follow-up question, Todd. This is for clarification for people just in general. With the fly-in and fly-out gigs, okay? So in a situation like that, you're sitting at home in San Diego and you get an offer to play, I don't know, Columbus, Ohio at a festival. So you fly in. When you fly in, do you guys then rent the drop-off? Just bring your physical guitars, or how do your instruments and your stuff make it from wherever you are to where you're playing if you're not out on tour?
You're chopping up a lot, but I know exactly what you were asking based on the logistics of that type of thing. What happens there is I have everybody brings their principal instruments. I actually have three keyboards, so I have to have that shipped in. But I take two Steinbergers on the plane with me in a custom case on the airplane. John checks his two basses in, which is horrifying, but he checks those in. And as does Pat with his guitars, I believe. For drummer, the kick pedals, the snare, or whatever their favorite thing may be in certain cases, and they check that. Then the back line we usually share with another group, or depending on the duration of the fly-in, fly-out thing, we could rent some gear. But it has to be cost-effective, because we can go into the red doing these shows, but we prefer breaking even at least to get out there. So that Yeah, it's a very good question, and usually the back line is already there, and we just utilize what we have. I bring my in-ear monitor system, and, you know, sometimes, even though you could be well-rehearsed, which is another topic, you don't go in there and wing it.
Well, so where do you guys fit in the scheme of things? Meaning, what I've noticed over the last number of years is how things seem to be cyclical. So even though you guys have a pedigree and you've been in the music business forever, we're seeing a shift where, you know, 5 years ago, REO Speedwagon was the band that was headlining these long weekend festivals. And they still do to a certain degree, but now you're starting to see more where it's Shine Down, some newer type metal bands, even though those guys have been around for a while. Do you see 4x Fate trying to make a swing at that type of a thing versus more of the 80s type stuff, even though you're playing new music?
Good question. Funny you mentioned REO Speedwagon. That was my first tour and the biggest I've ever done when I was playing with 707 back in 1980.
And I love REO. I just... Yeah, and I love REO. It's just, you know what I mean? It's constantly changing.
I understand the reference. Here's the good thing about us, I believe. We can do, if you do a thing where you're set up to play with a certain type of band or a structure of bands that are heavier, we've got enough material where we can be heavier like that. Or if we're playing with something that's a little bit more broader demographics of accessible, older style, we can also do that. So with a slight shift in a set list, we can pretty much morph into a very acceptable slot anywhere.
Depending on who you need to be.
Man, I really don't think we'd fit very well with that.
Todd, look, I'm getting some strange feedback now. Is anybody else hearing?
Yeah, it was good up until as of like a few minutes ago.
A few seconds ago, actually.
I heard all of Todd's last remarks, but then all of a sudden I'm starting to hear that it sounds like a truck.
Yeah. Yep.
Yeah. No, it seems better now. It's come back again.
Okay.
Mark, how's it for you, Mark?
The band can morph into, you know, playing with any type of genre, probably not thrash.
Well, yeah, but would you want to?
No.
Yeah. Well, hey. Todd, were you guys early on getting any pressure from, I don't know, managers, people around you saying, you know what, if you really want to succeed, you really should try and mimic the Ace Frehley, the KISS sound, because that's the fan base you're going to be appealing to. So why don't you force yourself to sound like that? Anybody pressuring you that direction?
Not really. We had some good influential friends that I think would have liked to have seen that happen. It's not going to happen because I really have no desire to take giant leaps backwards. I think that, you know, especially for musicians who are constantly writing and improving and growing as I am, all the time, even at 58 years old, I really had no desire to go backwards. And I really wouldn't, because I was kind of happy just doing my solo stuff. I mean, my principal form of income is not from music. So I really don't have to. I would like to make people happy with the project, but I don't think we'd reach enough people to do that. I think it'd be kind of pointless in the long term.
So you don't have to reveal what your principal source of income is, but because this isn't your primary source, is 4x Fate sort of something you just do for the fun of it then? Obviously you want to break even. You don't want to lose money doing it, but this is 4x Fate is not your survival.
Oh no. I think that we all hope that it will be a supplement to our incomes. I mean, that's the realistic view of it, because we all have different businesses. I think John's more retired than anybody else, but I'll let him speak to that. We all have different forms of income that are do very well for us. But, you know, in our hearts, we'd like to play and be able to at least, yes, break even and put some icing on the cake. Quite honestly, and most people know this, my family and I have some invested real estate, business real estate, of which I take care of all the time. And it's very, it's a good thing that I've got that, because, and it's been there for many years. and it enables me to continue to chase this music thing.
Well, it seems like you're always on a roof doing something, or you know, he's constantly like putting a whole new roof on, or he's pouring concrete, or he's, you know, building an old Chevy.
Yes, I was torching and welding. I was doing electrical. I was doing construction. Yeah, I grew up on a horse ranch, so I learned how to do all kinds of things. And yes, you are right, Tommy. There is nothing that I'm not doing at any given time, all at that same time.
Yeah, because I look at that and go, Jesus, he doesn't take a break. Because we chat back and forth every once in a while on Facebook.
No, and here's the wild thing. I think I broke my little toe last night at home. Not doing that stuff. Can you imagine that? I went, what the hell?
There's the problem. You just got to keep moving. So before we move backwards and go through some of this stuff, I've got one more question for you, because the music industry has changed. And I know that you've kept working on your solo material since the Frehley's Comet, and I know you've been on tour with Cheap Trick and different bands. We can cover all that, but how do you start where you are now? I mean, you get the idea, you put it together, you put this record together, now it's out. So what do you as an artist do? How do you get the word out there aside from podcasts and stuff like this? Is it working on getting on, different tours or festivals? Where do you start?
Well, social media, of course, is always the place to start. Incorporating the people that we know and we know, bringing them back into the fold, using all of the resources of friendships in the past and old fans of the past and bringing them back. I mean, I'm getting a lot of people contacting me now and say, hey, what's going on with this new band, 4x Fate? So we put our nose to the grindstones. We just get out there, and wherever a feed or a direction comes to us, we kind of analyze the possibility of how deep and how far we need to go with that lead so we can at least get some momentum in today's day and age. You know, I'll tell you, it was so much easier. Of course, it's easier with Frehley's Comet because it was Ace Frehley. Everybody's paying attention to him. But with this project, and maybe my combined age, you know, I don't think I've ever worked so hard in my life on anything to make it float. So we keep a strong focus on what we do, and we take in everything we can, advice, people, friends, directions, offers to help. I've got three or four this morning while I was trying to put up a new electrical outlet for my new little studio. It's just never ending. It's the reason why I weigh 140 pounds.
Well, yeah, and because the reason I ask that question is it brings 6 a.m. to mind. I'm not sure if you're familiar with them or not, Nikki Sixx's new band. And it's from seeing Motley Crue headlining at one of these festivals to now he's in his new band and starting all over again and playing in the middle of the day. And I was quite impressed when I saw them a couple of weeks ago, because they were out there, you know, shaking hands and doing meet and greets. And I thought, wow, that's pretty cool that he's willing to go back and start all over again. So it must be exciting also.
Yeah, it is. It very much so. I mean, if you have that type of desire to mingle and be with the fans or the people that appreciate your music or the people that will want to follow you and see what you're doing, then you got to do that stuff. I mean, we just did a week here a couple months ago or a month and a half ago back, death the whole time. But, you know, I felt so badly because the very last show I could hardly sing, and I wanted to be out there and shake hands and be with everybody, but I had to get back to the hotel and pass, or back to Rob's place and pass out because I was so damn tired. And sick. But yeah, you have to get out there and make that connection and have to be willing to do it, because now in this day and age, again, the fans, if you give them a bad impression, they're going to talk about it online. And guess what? You're dead in a couple of months.
That's a good point.
But before we start moving back to a couple of the other bands you've been involved in, what are your plans for 4x Fate moving forward? Obviously, we talked about how you'd love to get out and do shows, but I think you had mentioned in passing a second album. I mean, are you guys already talking about that?
Well, from the songwriter's point of view, yes, we're always talking about the next one. I think that's probably more stronger for Pat and me, and maybe even Rob Afuso, because he'll be more engaged. But that's the creative outlet that I enjoy. I like to sit down, write new songs, and think, oh, this would be great for this new project, I mean, for the next CD. But we really have to follow through with what we've done now. And we have on the plate out there with The End Records, and get it out there and make sure it gets some headway and make some tracks, because if we don't, then there's no reason to go out and do a second one. But it's always pretty much a desire for songwriters to continue writing and come up with something new, because we always envision the next new cool thing, because quite frankly, songs, you know, 3 years ago, or, you know, which is an eternity for a songwriter. And I don't want to sound like, you know, they're not a good recordings, but I'm tired of them in the sense of I want to move on. But, you know, when somebody hears it brand new, I mean, the reviews, people writing back to me are going, holy crap, this stuff is just smoking. You know, they're very happy. And by virtue of that, I'm reignited, re-excited by it, and all too willing to, again, put my nose in the grindstone and go at it with this band.
Todd, do you, and for people who have followed you from like the 707 days, it seems like early on you were kind of a melodic musician. You had more of a melodic feel. I mean, is that an accurate statement?
Very much so. For me, if it doesn't have a melody, I really don't have a purpose for it. And that stems from my songwriting back when I was a kid. I think my piano, I never had piano training, but my piano influences when I first started playing an instrument, it was in fact piano. I was singing before that, but because I learned that, you know, melodies and melodies structured over the right chords, always very important, because people don't realize they're emotionally struck by just the right melody, cadence, inflections over just the right chords and bass notes. I mean, the Beatles were just brilliant at doing that. And there's degrees of that where you reach the Stones and then all the types of bands. But yeah, I'm very much a melody man. And I like all the new bands that are out there right now. And I listen to a lot of new stuff, you know, on the iPhone feed. And it's amazing all the cool stuff that's out there. And they are utilizing the melodies over the chord structures, and some of that stuff is heavy, and some of it's, you know, the production is huge and big and maybe overproduced for some people, I don't know. But getting back to me, yes, it's got to have a melody, it's got to have some magic over those chords.
Well, so and where I was going with this is, do you, as a creative writer, musician, you know, recording music, do you see a point where you might go, you know what, I don't want to record something that's as heavy sounding, I want to get back and do something that is a little more melodic sounding?
Oh yeah, I do that all the time. Winter that I recorded in 2000 that doesn't have anything heavy on it. Well, not all practical purposes, nothing on it that's heavy at all. I would love the new movie scores. If you listen to the new patriotic song on the 4x8 Relentless CD, you'll hear Amber Waves. I recorded all the keyboards and then I did all the orchestrations. That's all one recording. I actually did that here in San Diego and took it and transferred it to in New York studio. So I wrote all the passages and all the cellos and oboes and all that type of stuff. So I can do that stuff. And yes, as I get older, next 2 years, I'll be 60. I want to think about, you know, what am I at? I can't do the heavier stuff anymore. Not that I couldn't, but what if, you know, there's people don't really want to hear that anymore, or they get tired of me in that genre. I'm very capable of doing more of for lack of better terms, you know, like, Seal, Phil Collins, earlier stuff, Sting, you know, very thought evoking type music. A lot of people may hate that stuff, but when I write it and play it, it comes out a little differently. But I can do
still,
a lot of types.
Well, it can still be heavy and melodic though.
Oh yeah. Oh yeah, very much so. I mean, it'll have some bottom in. It'll have some bottom in. I never get away from that. But it won't necessarily have my Steinberger, you know, on 11 with the Marshall stack behind it. It'll be something that has some body to it. Yeah, I can do it. You're right about that.
All right, so let's back up a little bit right before 4x Fate. So prior to 4x Fate. What were you doing? Were you a studio musician? Were you touring with other bands? Who were you working with?
Well, I wasn't working with anybody. I was working on actually getting ready to do another solo, actually two solo records. I was going to do another heavier one, but before I was going to do that, I was going to do a primarily just an instrument, not an instrumental, but an acoustic CD, very little production, just regular piano, regular acoustic guitar, and me singing, and nothing else really. And I still made that because it's kind of a fun thing to do. I just got to find time, of which I don't have right now. I was approached by a couple of big bands to go out with them. One of them, unfortunately, was just a little too close to the momentum of 4x Fate picking up. They asked me not to say anything at the time about it, but I guess that ship has sailed because they've already hired somebody else. But they're actually people I've been on tour with before with Cheap Trick, the band Heart. Okay. Wanted to know if I want to audition and play with them. Great band, you know, and I did work up a lot of the song, or you know, some of the songs, but then I had to bow out at the last minute because it was very apparent that 4x Fate was probably going to go somewhere.
Which is fair. You want to work on thing. Thing would have been cool.
It would have been fun, but the hired gun thing for me is like, really? Again?
Well, and the frustrating thing for me as a fan, just a quick mention with Heart, is I think their set list is horrible. You know, I want to, if I'm going to go see Heart, I want to hear Heart songs. I don't want to hear Led Zeppelin. You know, and it sounds like the last four or five songs of their set is Zeppelin. And it's like nothing against Led Zeppelin, but it's just like they've got so many incredible songs that they don't ever play that I would much rather hear those than whatever they're doing now. So I don't know, maybe you made the right choice.
Well, and I understand that from a fan's perspective. When I go see Alice in Chains, I want to hear Alice in Chains tunes, you know, So I understand that completely. I think from an artist standpoint, Heart is probably tired of playing some of their songs and they want to go back to their original roots, which was obviously and always Led Zeppelin. So they probably feel more compelled and have earned the right to do as such. But like you said, it's like, okay, a song or two, maybe in a, you know, 15, 16 song set, that'd be, but I haven't seen them. I don't know what they're doing as far as, their set list goes, but I do understand what you're saying.
Well, they were here in Minnesota and with Joan Jett, and I would have gone if Cheap Trick was opening, cause they're doing that, the three, whatever. And I looked at the set list after and like literally the last four songs are Zeppelin songs. And I'm like, but you know, for me, I like their mid 80s stuff, like Cities Burning and How Can I Refuse. There's so many great songs that they could play. So if they're sick of doing Magic Man, great. Give it a break. I don't care. I'd love to hear something off of any one of your other records. So I get where you're coming from. It's just from my perspective, it's like, I just want to hear their music because they're that good.
Right. And you know what? That's a very good perspective, because their early music and even later music was that good. That's what a lot of fans want to hear. And that's something that, you know, may be brought to their attention eventually. And they may turn that around for the next tour and do something, you know, differently. I'd like to hear a lot of their earlier stuff, you know.
Todd, and I would say the same thing about Cheap Trick in the mid 80s. I love that stuff. Yeah.
Well, yeah.
Todd, as a hired gun, how much opportunity do you have any input into stuff like this? You know, like you're sitting there at an, you know, rehearsals or whatever. Do you get a chance to say, you know what, we really, as a band, should change this set list a little differently, or here's the songs I'm hearing the fans really want, or is it in your best interest to sort of just sit there quietly and say yes sir, no sir?
It depends on the duration of the band, that you've been with, and the personalities in the band, and I play with all types. Frehley's comment, I wasn't really a hired gun, but band, you know, I was the next step up from a hired gun, I guess. So I had a lot of leeway and was given a lot of freedoms, which was fantastic. For Ted Nugent, you know, I was a side player and started out playing half keyboards, half guitars. And then Ted kept saying, well, what would you play on, you know, this part instead of keyboards? Can you play guitar on that? And so I started playing more guitar, but we weren't recording. Oddly enough, Cheap Trick, I'd go in the studio a lot with them for pre-production, and they would occasionally ask my opinion, more often than not, about a certain thing, and then I would help them with some song construction, especially for The Doctor, which one song ended up being on there exactly as the way I kind of produced it in Robin Zander's basement, or helped to bring it about, not produce it, but I would only interject if I was asked, because I think I knew better. Sometimes you say stuff and people look at you and go, shut the hell up. You know, it's not your band. You know, it's not your deal. It's not your future. It's not your ass on the line. So I understand that too. With each band, there's been a level of degree of dancing around the bushes, you know, and figuring out where you can step and where you can't. And the landmines became very apparent.
Can we talk about Uncle Ted for just 1 minute?
Well, let's go back to that, but real quick. So as somebody who's as creative and as talented as you, does that get frustrating that you can't contribute?
Was it frustrating for what?
Does it get frustrating for you that you can't contribute?
Well, in my first band, yes, I had really hard time with 707, because there's things I wanted to do, but I was the new guy. I was not a lead singer. They already had three lead singers and they really didn't want to hear me singing lead or singing period, or contributing a lot of songs. Which is weird because I was hired because I could write songs, but I was only allowed to write a little bit. I mean, that's just the nature of the band. That wasn't anything vindictive at that point, I don't believe. So at that point, it was very frustrating for me not to be able to contribute everything I was hearing, because I wanted things to be heavier for that band. And I think we probably would have done a little better had we gone heavier. But I had to bite my ass. Over the years, I learned that it's not going to make a lot of difference, because you're one guy out of the rest of the guys. If you are asked, then your opinion will have and carry more weight to it than if you get in there and, you know, blast away about your stupid opinion being the new young guy. Nobody cares.
Sure. Tommy, your question about Ted, Uncle Ted?
Yeah, I without getting into any politics, okay, because we want to avoid that like the plague here. I would like to know, because of all of the stuff that Ted loves to talk about, what is his demeanor like on a personal level when you're working with him in a band? Is he a nice guy? Is he hard to be around? Was it fun? What was it like?
I had a blast with him. I mean, I had only known him from touring on the big tours with 707 and speaking and a plethora of other bands of that era. And we got to know Ted pretty well. Ted is pretty much Ted on stage and off stage. He was more about, I think, hunting. I don't remember a lot of political stuff back then, because I didn't pay attention to it hardly at all, because I was so busy trying to forge my way. But he was very, very good to work with. very easy, very accommodating. He did what he needed to do as far as, you know, he's very, very frugal, which is a good thing to do when you're on a budget. He kept the penny to the penny, and that's the way it should be. That's the way he kept everybody out there playing. And then he discovered the fact that I could drive a car like a madman, so I became the other driver. So just picture Ted and me going down the Autobahn with the band and crew and two Mercedes doing 100 miles an hour, and trucks and other cars. It was quite the experience. Oh man, that was some hair-raising stuff.
When you were working with Cheap Trick, that was, because I remember seeing you multiple times, and that was late 80s, wasn't it? Mid to late 80s?
Like I started in 85, and then I stopped in late 86, and then I started back up again with them in 90 to 96.
Okay.
And then 2000. Right. Go ahead.
So many... and this is just opinion. So many artists that I enjoy have changed, like we all do as we get older, you know. Mm. But Zander keeps getting better. How is that possible? I said Robin Zander keeps getting better. How is that possible?
Well, I think that it probably because he's in it to sing. He's in it to please the audience and the fans and the friends, and so is Rick. They have never been any differently. I mean, and I spent a lot of time with them, and I just went on stage with them a few months back here in San Diego and played a song on guitar. They played Want You to Want Me, and they actually sang the choruses, which was hilarious. But Robin's voice... He is probably the most underrated, best American rock singer of all time, as far as I'm concerned.
I agree.
And he, I think, gets older. He probably is taking care of his voice more and better. I don't know all the particulars, but you know, he stopped smoking. I'm sure he keeps himself hydrated. And take care of his voice as far as hopefully maybe some rest. I don't know. When you get older, you do have to change your habits. Otherwise, you cannot sing. I know that very well. I've got to take care of my body. But I think overall, without asking them directly, it really is the fact that they want to do this, and so they make it happen.
Well, and do you think that is some of it? I mean, I get the whole part about taking care of yourself and staying hydrated and not smoking, but do you think some of it too is just, I know it's genetic, but is some of it also like the type of music you sing? For instance, is most of the songs with Cheap Trick, from your experience, well within the vocal range of what Robin sings on a regular basis versus, say, somebody else who was chasing a trend at a certain point in their career and can't hit those notes anymore because the music was different at the time? You know, because like to me, like if you look at the Beatles or Paul McCartney, even the stuff that he did with Wings and his solo stuff always seems to be in that comfort zone.
Yeah, well, you establish your character voice based on what you can do on the whole. Robin has a great voice and a great range of and a great style of singing, so he can continue to do most everything he's ever done. Now we have had some songs where they were such a scream, you know, and a high register that if the song was played too quickly, it was just virtually you could not get wind in there to sing the next notes, and that would always kill us. And we'd look at each other like, God bless, this is just too fast. We can't keep up, especially if I'm singing the high harmonies. But and then I think you learn from that, and so the next recordings, you don't do that anymore. And we all go through that. Yes, there are some other singers that probably chase that trend and discover that they cannot do that. And then genetically with age, your vocal cords, they're not as tight as they used to be. They don't bounce back, so you cannot recuperate after certain songs. I think genetics has a lot to do with it.
Okay. Todd, with all of the various bands you've played with in different capacities, if one of them came to you and said, you know what, we want you in the band. We want you to become a band member. No hired guns. Which one would it be?
Probably Stone Temple Pilots or Alice in Chains.
Okay.
Cool.
Those bands are old now. Even though I'm older, that is more along the lines of the stuff, because they really reflected a lot of the heaviness and the melodic that I've always wanted to do. So even though I was in the Comet and with all the other bands, including Cheap Trick, and they served, you know, a great musical influence for me. The back of my mind, I always wanted to be heavier and melodic. And when these two bands came about, I was like, oh, these bands are great. And I know a lot of fans are not going to like that because it's completely, you know, 180 from probably musical preferences from Frehley's Comet, Kiss, and all that, the other type of stuff. But for me,
but not really. But not really. I mean, the difference is flannel and another outfit. I mean, if you think about it, if you can close your eyes and just listen to the music, it's still similar.
If you close your eyes and listen to Carnival of Souls, it sounds just like Alice in Chains.
Similarities. You are right. But, you know, I'm speaking from the heart and from honesty. It's just if I was given the chance, I mean, besides Four by Fate, you know, if I was given the chance to do something like that, you know, I love that style of, you know, Lane's style. I can do that. And I can hear all those dissonant harmonies because I'm a keyboard player as well. And then Stone Temple Pilots, I always thought Scott was they're two brilliant singers who, you know, primarily for whatever the reasons may have been, you know, wasted their lives and their talent on going in a direction that they felt they had to go, which, you know, of course, ended their lives, unfortunately.
Right. Well, and that's interesting you say that too, because that's some of what I was thinking when I was listening to your CD. Is some of it sounded like Alice in Chains to me, like something right off of Dirt. You know, so you can definitely hear the influence. At least I could.
Yeah, it's a little bit of different timbre, and I've been accused of being a chameleon, and I don't really have my own style. And that kind of affected me when I was younger. I thought, really? I don't have my own style? But I know better than that now, because when I sing what I want to sing, like on the 4x Fate, that's me. That's my style. I'm not really going to deviate too much. I mean, I can gravitate towards, you know, the likes of the Stone Temple Pilots or Alice in Chains. But what you're hearing, I mean, I even sound like there's some David Lee Roth in there. If you listen to the new 4x Fate, you can hear – oh, that's another band, Van Halen, by the way. You can hear some stuff that sounds like, and I didn't do it on purpose, but it sounds dead ringer for David Lee Roth, a little bit of the inflections and the timbre. And I was quite surprised when I heard it go, oh, there's David. You know, David came to visit.
Yeah, well, and you can't go wrong with original Van Halen.
No, that's some powerful stuff.
Let's back up now to Frehley's Comet, the debut album, Second Sighting. You know, we had Eddie Trunk on, I don't know, a couple months ago, and had him on just to talk about his time with Ace Frehley, and he spent a good chunk of time talking about those albums and that period, and, you know, how, like, Second Sighting was just a complete rushed effort, and what do you remember from those, that back in that time period? I mean, what sticks in your mind?
Well, you know, it was good times. It was a frenetic schedule and pace, as it should be, as it should have been. I think that, you know, I loved recording the live EP was fantastic. And then with the impending Iron Maiden tour that we were doing in 1988, there was a lot of pressure, which I understand a lot more now, to put out a new record, which would be Second Sighting. The problem with that, of course, and most people know this, or maybe some people don't know, is the fact that we went to go record the album, and Ace was not ready. He did not have a lot of songs, or many songs, period, to do, or to put forth to record. So I said, well, you know, I've got a lot of tunes ready to go. as I always did back then, because I was always writing, I said, I can kick them in and we can see what we can make happen. And they said, okay, let's do that, including Ace. Then you contribute the fact that Ace, during the recording of this, he got a nasty case of bronchitis. So it was real tough for him to sing or even be at the studio some days and play. I mean, when he did come and show up, and he played some spectacular stuff, and he sang some great iconic tracks. But he wasn't there to give, I think, 100% of the time. So we had to make it work. And we did make it work. And what I did not expect was the backlash that I eventually got as, oh, second sighting. I guess that's Tod Howarth's project now, and Ace is being kicked to the curb, and it's all about Tod Howarth, Tod this, Tod that, trying to make it a solo band. And for lack of better terms I felt bad. I felt like, wait a minute, that was not my intention at all to make this the Tod Howarth record. I was trying to bring songs when there weren't any songs here. My contention really was to do a little bit more collaborating with Ace and give him some heads up on how to sing and sing more effectively to bring out what he had to offer to make it sound like, oh, this is really a band now. Well, we didn't get to do that because Ace was sick. So in giving my effort to add the songs and do what I could, I got slammed for it. And I felt like, wow, that's a slap in the face for trying your best and trying your hardest to make something work and continue. So that's kind of what I remember.
But that's the trolls. I mean, we get that every week here. There's just some people, no matter what you do, will never be happy because it's just not right. So like that.
I have a lot of people that hate me because I'm not Ace or I'm not Kiss or I don't do exactly that. But why
you
would
and Michael.
I mean...
You and Michael should start a fan club.
Trolls Anonymous.
Trolls Anonymous. No, we have getalife.com.
There is Get a Life, yeah.
I don't want to insult, you know, a lot of the followers because, you know, the KISS fans are the best fans in the world. I mean, from what I've gathered and what I've learned, they're alligators. When they clamp on, they don't let go, you know, and it's a really good thing because a lot of them carry on into what you or what an artist may do after, you know, Frehley's Comet or the KISS family tree, which is huge. But I can't be that because I was never that anyhow. Frehley's Comet is Frehley's Comet because that was me doing what I do. So, you know, and that's the best I can offer. I can't even. That's jumping into a time machine to try to go back and be something I never was.
So what led to your departure from Frehley's Comet then?
Well, after the Iron Maiden tour was canceled because we ran out of money,
when you say we, is that more of the record label pulled tour support?
Well, I think that there probably was a contention to pull or tighten the purse strings and probably some over expenditure on the role. I don't know if that, I was never quite into the deep end of the financials because, you know, it wasn't my band. So I really don't know why. But once it was established that the record was not doing as well, I mean, they could have put more money into It's Over Now as a third single, but they did not because Ace wasn't playing and wasn't singing, which I understand at this point.
Regarding that subject, did you read a certain book that goes into detail about that?
About It's Over Now?
No, about the tour running out of money.
No, I didn't read any of those books. Oddly enough, the books, the KISS books and all that stuff, and the comic books, I don't read any of those.
Oh, okay. Well, without going in, because then we'll get a bunch of IMs about the book. There is a book that goes into detail of Ace running out of money, and I do believe it was in the southern part of the United States. And
we are New Orleans, I think.
Yeah, so I was just going to ask you how accurate that was, but pretty time.
I don't think it's good question, Mark. I don't think it was fair to blame Ace on that. I think it's more the blame or the demise of the project at that point in time really fell on the fact that we probably didn't budget ourselves tightly enough on the road as a whole, and then the record company wasn't going to put any more money in it because they thought, well, let's just record another record down the line, and then we'll really push that. So,
well, John had way more to do with the business end than you did, though, correct?
Well, he had suggestions. Yes, he did, and he had suggestions about how to do the band, running the band. In that manner. And I can't fault him either because I don't know all the particulars. But I believe that in the end, I think it may have been the record labels that said, you know, enough is enough. Let's cut our losses and start over with a new record.
Yeah, I mean, it's not unheard of that back in the 80s, that's how the business worked. You know, you go out on tour, you're surviving because the record label's giving you tour support. You don't make enough money opening up each night to keep yourself on the road. You've got some additional income from a label supporting you. And it's pretty common knowledge that when an album doesn't perform as well as a label wants, they usually pull the money on it. And now it's left up to the band who, unfortunately, the band isn't making enough money to support themselves on the road. And therefore, you're done.
Well, and here's the nasty little mathematical equation to that. When the label gives you tour support, depending on how they do that, you can either be sponsored, which pays for part of it, and usually that's the majority of the bill, but the label is footing your future money. So yep. What the band is doing is going further into debt.
Yep.
So the accountants go, what is the probability of this band surviving on this record and the next record based on how much money we're shoveling into them, of which we'll never see back? And that's when they make the decision to cut your throat.
Yep. Yeah.
And the reason to finish that question, when it came down that everybody went home and we were out of money, and then it came back to me as, look, for the next record, which would have been after Second Sighting, we're going to have Ace sing and write all the tunes, and we're not going to have you do that. So I had no choice but to leave because that was the only way I was going to make a name and some money or income, livelihood for myself. And I felt like, well, that's pretty devastating for me because it's not only a slap in the face, which I can take, but it's also I have no way of earning a livelihood.
So if
and
it
I
was,
had to take a chance.
If it was up to your decision, you could have remained in the band.
Oh, yeah, I could have stayed. I called Ace and I said, look, you know, I'm sorry to make this decision, this call, but I'm going to have to withdraw. I'm going to have to quit the band and try to see what I can do on my own. And he told me flat out, I said, oh, well, I'm sorry to hear that. I really wish you wouldn't, but I understand what you feel you have to do. I understand that, but, I wish you'd stick around. And that was, I'm paraphrasing, but that's pretty much what he said.
So after the Frehley's Comet became the Ace Frehley band, I mean, that's essentially what happened, is it just all of a sudden one album morphed into a different band name. Were you able to, I don't know, emotionally, mentally, were you able to rebound from that pretty quickly, or did it kind of hit you and were you kind of like knocked to the side a little bit?
Oh, with the Trouble, was it Trouble Walking album, I think it was?
Well, with that whole, the whole thing of Frehley's Comet, the first album comes out, it's getting a lot of great attention, then what goes on into the second album and all the fiasco behind that, and then you leaving the band. I mean, how did that sit with you? I mean, were you able to just be like, oh, cool, I'm just moving forward, I'm just grabbing another, starting my own project, or did this was something where you were like, man, that sucks, because there was really some potential here? And
yeah, no, I was, not to sound cold-hearted, but I was nowhere near devastated. There were other contributing factors in my life that were taking place that may have helped dilute that effect, but no, I was not devastated at all because I thought, well, one door slammed shut, maybe a couple more will open up. And I've always looked at it that way because that had been the pattern since 1979 for me when I first moved to LA. I was used to the fact that things will look like they're going to go well and things are going to go great. And, everything just turned to crap, you know, and I really learned that lesson with 707. So here now I've been through, you know, three major bands and now I'm into Ace Frehley. So it wasn't like it was unexpected. I thought, here we go again. I thought I'll just move on, do what I can do. And consequently, I ended up getting my solo band or my Tod Howarth band in San Diego signed to Gene Simmons' record label in 1991, I think it was. 90 or 91. So I always looked forward. I always looked ahead. I always looked to see what I could do. And I was willing back then to put the work into it that I'm doing the same work today.
So that's another KISS connection.
Talk to us about that little bit of Gene Simmons' record label connection. You know, what was, you know, there's stories out there how he was very controlling and in charge of like the whole House of Lords project. I mean, was he somebody tough to deal with?
I don't know his integral dealings with other bands. I do know that, yes, he is pretty controlling, only from the outside opinion of that most people that are successful are very controlling and opinionated. That doesn't always settle well with everybody, but that's just the way it kind of works. He had suggestions about certain projects, not so much about my band, was called Hardware. And when we got signed, it was through the channels of submitting a demo to his company. And then it got to him, and I already knew him, but it got back to him through his people. So he never got to the real controlling aspect with that band. We had a few meetings with him. He told us what we should do. And but by the time that we started to make any headway, grunge had come in and just leveled everybody.
So basically the deal didn't happen because the label basically just fell apart at that point in time.
Well, we were signed to Simmons Records. And I think the distribution was going to be through Warner's. I'm not sure if that's correct or not. I don't remember now. But once we did the showcase for the label, they passed on us because that's when, again, grunge was coming in, just blowing everybody out of the water. And they had no interest in investing in an 80s, late 80s style band when there was all this fresh pickings that were far cheaper to invest in too, and far more successful.
What are you, have you listened to a lot of Ace Frehley solo records post Frehley's Comet?
Nope. And it's not because I didn't want to. I mean, I've heard songs and I have my opinions about the songs. I heard probably a little bit more from his, not this last album, not the cover album, although I did hear some cover stuff, but the album before that,
Space Invader.
Yeah, I did hear some tracks off that. You know, I have my opinions about it. I don't think it'll be do anybody any good to hear my opinions about it. And I say this about a lot of music, but you know, certain things, certain songs, certain approaches, certain energy, certain drive, certain dedication really becomes apparent. And if it doesn't hit a level of what I put into my music, then I really have no desire to listen to it.
That's fair. You know, honest opinion is always a good thing.
Yeah. And I've heard some of the things I have heard. It's actually pretty cool that the way he did it, the way he put it out. It's not my style. I wouldn't have done it that way. So it's just kind of the fork in the road for these two particular to compare my stuff and Ace's stuff. At this point, it's two different things. I have not listened to a lot of his stuff, so I may not be giving it a fair assessment. However, I can say this at the same time, which may sound like I'm talking on both sides of my mouth. I've never had a greater appreciation and respect for what Ace has done and accomplished over the years. as I have in the last couple of years of you know, reviewing the stuff that he's done in the past and our stuff and even some of his new stuff. So the respect level is jumped even more so than when I play with him.
Let's go back to the debut Frehley's Comet album, because that seems like the album that was most likely a band effort as compared to Second Sighting. How much work was Eddie Kramer involved in working vocals and fine-tuning performances and just, I don't know, getting it out of Ace, getting it out of everybody to get the best possible performance?
I think that Eddie Kramer had already established a recording relationship with the guys, and then I came in, you know, part way. I think he contributed a lot. I mean, aside from the fact that he was legendary, more than I knew about when I first got in the studio with him. And besides, he was a great guy. He had very good suggestions. He had contributed a lot to the tracks that I remember playing on, singing on, and then we delivered. I mean, there's some powerful stuff there. So I think as a producer, he did a very good job, and everybody learned a lot from him. And he was always striving, I think, to get the best possible performances. I remember him saying, well, try it this way, or try it again, or try it harder, or try it that way, which is his job as a producer. So it was very pleasurable and a learning experience for me, as I remember. And it was fantastic.
Having been in the studio with Eddie and Ace, is Ace the type of musician who needs a strong producer to get the best out of him, or can he self-produce?
Ace, anybody can self-produce. Ace can self-produce, but I think that a huge credit to Ace is he will take direction on a lot of things, and he does do that, and he'll listen back, and he'll acknowledge the fact that it was a good idea. So he is very good at doing that, and he should be. He's had years of experience of working with very good producers. So when Eddie would give him a suggestion, he would do it. And then even when we were doing Second Sighting and I would suggest a different inflection or phrasing on how to sing something or maybe approach it on a very few times that I would on a guitar level, he would listen and he would do it and he would try it. I can't exactly remember what worked and what did not work, but he was not a prima donna about that at all. So his malleable level as far as someone giving him a positive critique or suggestion was huge.
In all of the records you've been part of that you've recorded, where does Frehley's Comet, the debut, stand for you?
I think it stands probably number one for me because, I mean, Second Sighting, of course, had It's Over Now, which is a different topic, but I think that I finally got to write a heavy tune. I finally got to sing. I finally got to play the inflections on my guitar chords that I like to play. I didn't have to play what somebody else wanted me to play because I'm a keyboard player. I don't play like normal guitar stuff. I mean, I'm not a virtuoso, but I have strange inversions on guitars and strange fingering. So I was thrilled that I got to do what I got to do on that record. I was very happy, and I thought it was a good representation of freedom.
Good answer.
Do you think if that Frehley's Comet lineup got together and you got Eddie Kramer, is it possible to capture that magic again?
Yes. Yes, very much so. I mean, that would be probably, and this is speaking from my heart, and I'm sure I could speak for John and probably Anton at this point, because, you know, Anton is, he's, even though we haven't spoken a lot in the last few years, he's a great guy and good friend. That would be one hell of a powerful assembly to take the time to build it so it could be the continuation of perhaps, you know, after the Second Sighting with Anton back, and or a continuation after the first record, my contribution and suggestion would be to make it very heavy. And, we could, because Anton is a monster. John Regan is even more of a monster now than I think than he was then. My style is even heavier because it's allowed to be heavier. And Ace can, again, he can do any style, and the heavier for him, the better it is. And then with Eddie Kramer, with his background, that would probably be, another super effort, not a super band, but maybe a super effort.
You know, just speaking as a KISS fan and as an Ace Frehley fan, even though I'm accused of hating Ace, that honestly, for me personally, is something that's right up there that I would love to see an attempt to recreate. You know, amongst all of the get KISS in the studio with Bob Ezrin or Eddie Kramer, I would love to see a real solid Frehley's Comet second album. Because to me, Second Sighting, no disrespect to you, but Second Sighting didn't live up to the Frehley's Comet debut. I think that would be awesome if that ever had an opportunity exist.
That is no offense taken at all. I have never had this question posed to me at all, and I never even thought of this. I mean, I consider myself to be, fairly educated for, Trailer the Park boy, but the fact remains that I've never been approached with that thought. And when you brought it up, I'm going, oh my God, the demographics right there, that reach would be, can I cuss on this broadcast here? Fucking huge. It'd be fucking huge because that was the best part of Frehley's Comet from a lot of the fans' perspectives. And I have to agree because it was the first thing Ace put out after KISS. So you have Anton, John, me, and Ace, and Eddie Kramer doing that. I would have to say that would probably be a reunion that would be worthy of a lot of the big bands' reunions they're doing now because they need to make money. I would like to see it from the standpoint of not only lining the pocketbook a little bit, but moreover for Ace and for the fans. I think they'd go out of their minds for that. That is a great idea.
I to me, it's like, I don't think Frehley's Comet saw its fullest potential. Amazing debut album, and then Second Sighting just didn't live up to it. And I felt like there still is a Frehley's Comet album that should be done. And, and when I posed that question to you, you answered yes so quickly. It was just like, holy crap, he didn't even have to think about this.
Because when you brought it up, in my mind, I have an ego, but it's in check because I'm old and because I've been slammed down so many times, I don't care about it. But I have an ego that likes to survive. But moreover, I have a perspective of like, what's going to be successful? What do the fans want to hear? And when you didn't even have to finish the sentence. When you start bringing up the lineup and Eddie Kramer went, oh, I know where he's going with this. That's fucking brilliant. Why the hell didn't I think about that? Why didn't any of us think about it? And maybe we did, but we were so busy.
Because you need to come on Three Sides.
Yeah. Because you need to talk to people who hate Ace to give you the real passion.
There you go. See, we're already roping in a broader demographic.
Exactly. We don't drink the blue Kool-Aid here.
No, we don't.
Oh, we love those Ace. We love those Ace Frehley fans.
You're saying a lot there, Mark. What are you doing over there, Mark?
He never says anything.
I'm taking it all in.
I bet you are.
So as a follow-up to that thought, though, realistically, and obviously there's finances that are behind all of that, do you think Ace would be able to do an album where he's not singing lead on every song at this point? Would he be able to share lead vocals with somebody else?
Well, that question would probably be best posed to him.
Sure.
If he was smart, We do the very same thing because he knows, and he's first admitted, and he admitted it back then. He wanted to sing because he knew the fans wanted to hear him sing, and the fans should hear him sing. But he also wanted I'm not patting myself on the back, but a real lead singer. And that's why I was in, one of the reasons why I was put into the band. I'm not a spectacular lead player. I'm a songwriter, lead singer. So I think that it'd be very smart of him to accept that. And quite frankly, I don't really see myself agreeing to doing that type of project without me singing at least half of the record. Because, again, it's like, okay, if we're going to do this, let's do it right. We could split some vocals. That's fine. But, if I'm going to make the investment in this as everybody else is, we should do it exactly like it was going to be for the real second album. I really heard any of his latest stuff. I think he's splitting up some vocals with somebody else on that. And it's a smart thing for him to do because it gives him an opportunity to showcase his guitar playing, because that's what he is, a guitar player.
Well, on right. His last two full albums, he sung lead on everything. The covers album, he had some guest vocalists come in, but he sung the majority of them. And, just speaking for me personally, I'm a fan of Ace Frehley, the lead guitarist. As a KISS fan, that's what I fell in love with, was Ace Frehley lead guitar, not Ace Frehley singing. And there's nothing wrong with Shock Me and the few songs he's done with KISS, but that's not what I want from Ace. I want to hear great songs with great vocals and Ace Frehley's lead guitar.
Well, that's what I would tailor it around. I mean, my condition would be, I mean, there'd probably be a few of them, but my condition would be as I've always argued, Ace Frehley is a guitar icon. He is not a lead singer icon. He's got a character about his voice that lends that notoriety to him and his fans, but let him do what he does best, which is exactly what you said, smoke on the guitar. Let me write and help Ace write and co-write some songs which showcase his ability to smoke on the guitar, and whenever necessary, to sing those songs with some balls of conviction of what he, that says, I know what I'm doing here because I've been in on this from the beginning. And the thing is, we could do this type of project with the time frame allotted while, John and I are pushing for by fate and doing that, because nowadays, there's no full-on tours anymore. That just doesn't happen. So it's very doable. I mean, that's the only reason I'm probably talking about this, is because it's a very realistic probability while we work on 4x Fate and the excellent 13 songs that are on it.
Right.
There you go.
I think it's an attractive thought. It really is. But with the right conditions,
Sure. And it's the conditions that always make it more difficult to achieve.
And we'll have to check with Ace's schedule and see what he's doing.
So many cooks in the kitchen,
Oh, yeah.
So, Todd, where can our listeners learn more about you as the solo artist and 4x Fate? Put on your Gene Simmons hat and plug away.
There we go. There's a lot of avenues. I think right now the Facebook 4x Fate is very informative. My Facebook page, personally, it tells a lot about 4x Fate. Unfortunately, for some people, they may not want to hear some things, but I'm kind of ramping that back a bit. The record label, The End Records, has a lot of information about us. We have a website that's up, that's still being built up, so it's ramping up to be more informative. There are some other Facebook pages that are friends by faith. There are a lot of offshoot fans that are very up on what we're doing. This engine is just now starting to happen. I try to keep on it as much as possible for what we are doing, but I think after the release of the record on Friday, we will really be kicking it in the high gear, and I think I'll be paying more attention to 4x Fate Facebook page than anything else to let people know what's going on, where you can order the CD through The End Records and Amazon and all the outlets that will be popping up. The physical CDs seem to be very important to a lot of our fan base. Digital downloads are available as well. So that's something that is there and ready.
I was going to say, here's some homework. If you're listening to this and you want that Frehley's Comet reunion, go over to Ace's Facebook page and just start leaving all kinds of posts saying you want him back in Frehley's Comet.
There you go. Why not? Well, and Todd's very accessible too for you folks, so it's like, you know, chat with him a little bit.
Yeah,
get out there, buy the disc.
I definitely stretch myself very thin. I do that all the time, but I will do it as long as I have the energy and as long as I'm standing. When people write to me, message me, like my phone now is blowing up. And they didn't even know, oh my God, there's no way I'm catch up with this tonight. But there are, I always try to at least reach out to as many people as I can to answer the questions truthfully and encourage them about whatever may or may not be going on. I don't make shit up. I try to give hope to anything they may have hopes for. And I always will try to be informative. And so is John. John Regan is very good about that. And does a lot of that workload because he's not, you know, on top of a roof doing 24,000 square feet.
Hey, I do have since I don't have to wait in the queue here. You did some backing vocals on Penetrator. How did you end up working with my Uncle Ted?
Uncle Ted. Well, we were on tour with Ted 707 back in the early 80s actually. And when we left our manager then, Ted and Ted's manager, co-manager, wanted to manage us. So we ended up going with them for a while until the band 707 fell apart and disbanded. At that point, Ted had said, actually, it may have not fallen apart just yet, but he wanted to know if Kevin Russell, the guitar player, lead guitar player, and I would sing backups while we recorded at the record plant in San Francisco where Kevin and I lived at that time. So we agreed to do that, and we had a lot of fun doing it. They had virtually all of Billy Squire's band doing the whole record, and Brian Howe singing all the songs, who went on to sing with Bad Company. And that's how that transpired. And then shortly after that took place, 707 was done. I moved back to San Diego, and Ted's camp got a hold of me, I think early January or late December of that fiscal year, and said, look, can you come out and do the tour with us? So that's when I started playing with Ted for half of 1984.
Cool. Thanks. I was just always curious about that.
Sure. Sure. Thanks, Mark, for sharing it.
Todd, this was fun. This was fun. I loved chatting with you and getting a little bit of history on all the many bands you've worked with here.
Well, Michael, I appreciate getting in contact with me, you and Tommy and Mark, and asking me the questions that many have not been posed in that manner, especially the one we talked about with Eddie Kramer and Frehley's Comet. It's always good to reiterate, what the truth is and what I know to be true because I lived it. I'm always very grateful for the opportunity that you have given me.
Thanks, Todd. We appreciate it.
Thanks, Todd. We really appreciate it.
Thanks, guys.
Try not to break another toe.
I only got one good little toe left, so I'll try not to, but thanks, man.
Take care. Guys. Bye.
Have a great summer.
Want to get your official Three Sides of the Coin logo and shocker tee? Now you can. We ship worldwide. Get yours online at shop.threesidesofthecoin.com.
Mark, sorry. I mean, I know you were dealing with a lot of work stuff, and that's cool. That always comes first. But there was some cool stuff that Todd was talking about. You know, it was really kind of cool to get his little bit of insight into all the bands he's worked with, and just his feelings about a Frehley's Comet reunion.
And let me say too, I've met him a bunch of times through the KISS conventions, and even at Cheap Trick shows. He's very nice. He's like one of those really super approachable type of people. A good egg, as they say. He's a good guy. Nice having him on.
Easy to talk to. Yeah. Well, yeah, and it's fun to hear some of that stuff from his perspective, and I love to talk about the music business in general and how they're going to launch, you know, 4x Fate and the stuff that you got to kind of go through as a new band. It's got to be really challenging, you know?
Yep.
So it'll be interesting to see what happens over the next eight months.
You know, KISS Army, go out there, support 4x Fate. It's got a KISS connection to it. If you're one of those crazy completist KISS fan collectors, this has to be in your collection because it's got John Regan, it's got Tod Howarth on it.
Tommy and Mike, remember in Goldmine, they'd always have the parentheses, like if it was whoever was attached to the band that you like. I used to dig that too. Like, it'd be like X Ace for, and it would always be like in the KISS thing,
right?
And then if you'd go see Aerosmith, it would be whoever, you know, this guy was associate. I always thought that was cool in Goldmine. They really did a good job. I digress. But when you said that, I'm like, the first thing I remembered was thumbing through those little tiny things.
What I always liked is before the internet, that was a great way to discover other bands and other music.
Yes.
Is because you'd like, oh, I didn't know. Using Tod Howarth. Oh, Tod Howarth was in this band called 707? All right, well, let me go. I liked what he did in Frehley's Comet. Let me go find something on 707. And then, you know, it's just you start tracing that family tree of all the people that have been connected, and you will find some really cool new music, some great old music. That's how you discover stuff, is you just follow the lineage of a band.
It's like rockancestry.com. You get a leaf.
Yeah.
I remember like stuff like, was it Jimmy Crespo? I didn't know he was in a band called Flame. It was literally going through Goldmine. I'm like, oh, this is a band that he was in, you know, before Aerosmith, and, you know, going to check it out. And I found lots of great, great stuff that way. I miss that. That was fun. You know what I mean? That was way more fun.
Some of the local record stores still do that. You can go to the KISS section, and everyone that's associated, their albums will be in there, which is really cool.
Yeah.
But you got to really know who's who. There's not a lot of people left, I think, that know the history of a lot of these different bands. So if you say Jimmy Crespo, there's some who'll be like, huh? I thought it was Joe Perry.
In the KISS world, there's an incredible website out there called KISS Related Recordings. And that's all that website does is recordings that are related to KISS. It's not the FAQ of the KISS albums. It's what album did Eric Singer play drums on one song, and what album did Bruce Kulick play the lead guitar on this track. It's a great resource to go find all that type of stuff to discover. Again, you discover new bands. You're like, I didn't know Eric was on that one. I didn't know, you know, Peter guest vocaled or sang, you know. And it's the minute details too. It's not just that they were in the band, it was somebody contributed something to that album.
It's the minutia,
as we love to say. All right, homework.
Someone put music to those lyrics.
Somebody put music.
Please,
to the Vinnie. That's one. Put music to the Vinnie Vincent lyrics that we're gathering. And something related to Todd. What's your favorite Todd recording that he's been part of, band that he's been part of? I mean, he's been a part of a lot of stuff.
Yeah, and would you like to see a Frehley's Comet reunion?
And here, let me preface that by saying, would it be a live performance reunion or just get together, record an album, and just release a new Frehley's Comet album with no touring? Because that's feasible too. Might even be more feasible.
It's possible.
All right, there you go.
There you go, guys.
We've got a special guest next week, right?
Yes, we do.
Ooh, it should be an interesting one. Tommy brought this guest in. Tommy brought this
one. Well, we are going completely left turn with this one.
Meet him at the mailbox?
I don't live in an apartment complex. What are you trying to say?
Oh my God! Before Mark's not even home, so we don't even know what he might be having for dinner.
Oh, Liz already texted me. Hungry.
Yeah, what'd she text? What is it?
Hold on.
Did you see that someone posted sweet and sour meatloaf recipe?
Yes, I did. Another reason we love our fans.
Hold on a second. Are you doing three sides at work? Yes. Here we go.
Okay,
chicken, sausage, burgers, mozzarella, and tomato salad, which I love. I said, leave it on the corner. She said, it'll be in the fridge. Just rewarm it. That's it. So done. So I got that to look forward to.
Mark's
got
to go home and warm up his dinner.
And warm up his food. Although, I tell you what, wow. My birthday weekend, freaking incredible. We did all kind. We were just cooking outside like freaking crazy. It was incredible. Bought a whole new brand new outside set. The backyard is rocking like 10 men, so life is good.
Did you just roll in bacon or something?
I did. That was pretty much it.
Rolled around in bacon.
Bacon twister.
What where is your mind?
I know where it is.
He's like, yeah. He said, yeah.
He just says that to appease you. Just makes you happy. Because you want that image in your head.
All right.
All right, guys. That's it. Three Sides of the Coin. We are out of here. See you next week.
For interviews and media inquiries, contact Izzy at IzzyPresleyProductions.com.
Download your free copy of the KISS School of Marketing.
11 Lessons I Learned Working with KISS.
The number one downloaded business book on Noisetrade. Go to books.noisetrade.com/Michael Brandvold.
You're listening to Three Sides of the Coin.
Love the show. Go to iTunes.ThreeSidesOfTheCoin.com and leave your review and rating of Three Sides of the Coin. Thanks.